All right. So when we were trying to decide opening speakers, it's always difficult because keynotes and you have opening speakers and you want to set the tone, the right sort of tone for the opening talk. And I've gotten to know Catherine Bleich pretty well over the past, like, it's been like 4 years now since the Ron Paul movement. I've entered through the Ron Paul movement, and then things have evolved. She came to Pork Fest and spoke, and then, you know, I've seen her at a bunch of different events around the country. And then she got involved with this guy. And when she came up to speak, I heard her speak at Pork Fest, and she goes, "Hey, I'm coming over to Liberty Forum." So I heard her speak at Pork Fest, and I said, "You're opening speaker at Liberty Forum next year." And she goes, "What?" And I said, "I want that same fire." So either 2 years ago or 3 years ago, she spoke at Liberty Forum, and she brought John with her, and John spoke in the Hunt Club on Thursday night beforehand, and I was like, damn, I kind of wish I had a space for him to speak because I like the fire in his belly. And it's been great seeing John speak across the nation at some of the Nullify Now conferences, at some of the tag stuff. He's very active in Austin. And it always kind of, you know, it's kind of funny because we always joke, we need you here, right? And, you know, he's kind of homesteading. He just started a family there in Texas. And I always think of him as like a kindred spirit. Whether John and his family eventually moved to New Hampshire or not is kind of moot because I think like he's a brother in arm in Texas. So he may not be a free stater in New Hampshire, but he's a free stater in Texas. So I always think it's great that that John is a part of this. And John has a topic that I think, and the cool part is none of you guys know what he's going to talk about because you don't have the booklet yet. And when he sent me the title of his topic, I literally said, that is perfect. Because it definitely fits in what John has been talking about for the past 2 years going around the country. He kind of talks about Agenda 21 a lot. And you guys know what Agenda 21 is? If you don't, John will tell you. But what he's going to present to you is a twist on that that I think is absolutely, I think it's going to be like a little a manifesto, if you will, and something that people can grasp, and it's going to be great for our movement. So please welcome John Bush.
How's everybody doing this afternoon? This morning. Aha. Feels good to be in the Free State once again. Once we crossed the border, I felt that status, that weight lift off my shoulders. I wish that Catherine and our new baby girl, Aliana, could have been with us. And the reason why they're not here is because of our favorite federal agency, the TSA. Catherine refuses to go through a pat-down. I'm not as consistent as she is, as I always learn. I've gone through one pat-down, but I was willing to go through it again to come speak to you guys and hang out with a lot of my great friends that I've met over the years. Thankfully, I missed the pat-down. Let me give you a quick note on how to avoid pat-downs. It doesn't always work, but a lot of it's about eye contact. So there's two rows that they usually have. Sometimes one has a scanner and another one doesn't. And what I do is the TSA agent that's directing you to the scanner line, just don't make eye contact with him. Fiddle with your hands or pull your ID out. Sometimes it works, somebody else will go up or the other guy will call you. Sometimes it doesn't work, and it didn't work for me this time, so I was called to the line. One of them had a non-functional scanner, the other one had a functional scanner, and they called me in to the line with the scanner. And so I just waited for the other guy in the line with the non-scanner to stop paying attention, and I did a little. So thankfully, my chances went to 0% that I'd have to get a pat down. But Catherine's not willing to take that risk, and I respect her for that. And more importantly, we're not willing to allow our daughter to witness her parents subjected to that kind of tyranny because we want her to grow up valuing her freedom. And I think it would be detrimental to that for her to see her parents go through that. But don't worry, we're buying an RV for Pork Fest. So. Another thing that was different about being in New Hampshire this time around without Catherine is things seem to be a little brighter because I'm not in her shadow this time around. But I do want to thank Catherine. She's probably watching on a live stream right there. I love you very much, and thank you so much for introducing me to the Free State Project. It's really been a major for me in my growth as an activist. So the title of my speech today is Agora 21. A counter-economic approach to building a free society in the 21st century. We're at a crossroads in history. We could go down one of two paths. One of them, total despotism, despair, desperation, darkness, a return to the old world order, if you will. The other path would be a new age of enlightenment, whereby individuals recognize their inherent individual liberty, and they stand up and unite, and they exercise that inherent freedom. That choice falls upon us, which path we take. It's been clear to me after a decade of research that there exists a tiny minority elite that is manipulating world events. And now they are doing anything they can to secure their position of privilege and power. And now that we have such a technological advance that's taken place, if these individuals manage to put themselves in power and build their technocratic dictatorship, which is happening right beneath our very eyes, it may be possible that they'll end the cycle of revolutions and maintain that position of power forever. They have the technology that's capable of doing that. Thankfully, a lot of their own technology we're using against them. There's individuals, families, trusts, non-governmental organizations that have adopted a long-term strategy for carrying out their goals of total control. And they've been putting their plan into place for a long time. In recent years, we've experienced a dramatic loss of our liberty and our inherent individual freedom, and that's not by accident. The purpose of my talk today is to call on libertarians, liberty activists, to also adopt a long-term strategy for bringing about and securing our individual liberty. This is essentially what Agora 21 is. It's a work in progress. I hope to publish Agora 21, a large document like Agenda 21. It hopes to provide a framework that liberty activists can utilize in order to create a genuinely free society, not a half-measure free society like the Constitution granted us, but a genuinely free society whereby individuals can carry out their life according to their own ends without being forced to do things against their will. So Agora 21 is a play on Agenda 21. And for those of you not familiar with Agenda 21, it's essentially a 1992 United Nations plan that was brought out at the United Nations Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. It essentially uses environmental alarmism to create an eco-fascist, collectivist, centralized, totalitarian world government. Straight up, that's exactly what it does. It calls on local, state, federal, and international governments to implement controls from higher energy rates to permitting processes before you can build onto your home to taxing us all to death to abandoning free market principles. If Agenda 21 was fully implemented, we would see a complete loss of our private property rights, what we have of them today. We would see the collectivization of world social and governmental institutions. And finally, we would see a dramatic reduction in the world's population. And to be clear, they state that either we need to reduce the population by 85% if we wish to continue to exist at the current standard of living, or we don't have to eliminate 85% of the population, but everybody's going to have to live as serfs with a dramatically reduced standard of living. And this is exactly what they call for in their Global Biodiversity Assessment, which is a document released shortly after Agenda 21 explaining how to implement Agenda 21. Many people would consider Agenda 21 to be the new world order, but it's not. As I said before, essentially it would be a return to the old world order of feudalism, stagnation, desperation, despair, where individuals didn't even recognize that they were inherently free and everything was done for the benefit of the king. Sounds kind of familiar. Unfortunately, for those who subscribe to the philosophy of liberty, Agenda 21 has affected every facet of our lives. It's ever present here in the free state of New Hampshire and just about every one of the larger cities in New Hampshire. It's also present at the state level, and the federal government is bypassing the state level and implementing it. There's also NGOs like the International Council of Local Environmental Initiatives, which carries out Agenda 21 through stealth means at the local level. Thankfully, there's some state representatives, again, leading the way here in New Hampshire that have introduced a bill that would call on the state to examine and study Agenda 21, and I think that first step would really do a lot to pull this nasty plan out into the light of day. Now, Agora 21, unlike Agenda 21, would work towards bringing about a wholly free society. In order to accomplish this goal, Agora 21 calls on individuals to utilize the libertarian strategy of agorism, which was laid out by Samuel Edward Konkin III in the New Libertarian Manifesto. agorism is essentially derived from the word agora, which is a Greek word for market. And what agorism would have us do is, rather than competing within the state, it would have us compete with the state by building what he coined as the counter-economy, which is essentially black and gray markets. Black markets being those activities, goods or services, which are prohibited entirely by the state, like prostitution, the dispense of marijuana, and then there's gray markets, which is essentially those activities, goods or services, which you can only exercise or engage in if you ask permission from the state first, like carrying a concealed firearm without a license, driving without a license, given a haircut without a license, like you guys are doing up here in New Hampshire, which is great. So in order to better explain the concepts behind Agora 21 and to better vet out what agorism truly is, I'm going to be juxtaposing, comparing and contrasting Agenda 21 with Agora 21 and agorism. And the first comparison I'd like to make is a similarity, actually. Both Agenda 21 and Agora 21 reject the American form of constitutional governance. Agenda 21 rejects the American Constitution because they believe it has too much freedom for the individuals. It created national sovereignty, supposed national sovereignty. There's a Bill of Rights. There's a court system, which originally was based on common law. And of course, Agenda 21 would do away with all this. They would create one international state. All of the states below would have no autonomy. They would be completely subservient to this body. There would be unelected councils. There would be international courts. There wouldn't be local courts. Everything would go through one centralized system. So it would also reject a representative form of government. Now, Agora 21 also rejects the American constitutional form of government, but not because we believe there's too much freedom with the American Constitution, but there's too little freedom with the Constitution. So there's an area that we have similar. And to further hash out that idea, I'd like to just give a quick mini treatise on my views of the Constitution. Many people fail to recognize that the United States Constitution actually created an environment of less freedom than there was before the Constitution. We had the Articles of Confederation, which didn't have a strong central government like the U.S. Constitution does. Additionally, many call the Constitutional Convention a constitutional coup d'etat. It was John W. Burgess, a constitutional scholar and founder of the first American graduate program of political science at Columbia University in 1880. He wrote in his book, Recent Changes in American Constitutional Theory, that the Constitutional Convention was essentially supposed to just be an amendment process for the Articles of Confederation. And the process that was supposed to take place was the delegates were supposed to come up with amendments and then bring them back to their respective legislatures in the Commonwealths for approval. This is, of course, not what happened. They simply scrapped the old system and instituted a new system. So one of the questions I ask is, you know, how can we expect the Constitution to secure our individual liberty when the Constitution itself was founded in an unconstitutional manner? Additionally, as Benjamin Tucker points out, this is a really great quote here from his journal Liberty, the Declaration of Independence declares that governments derive their just powers from the consent of the governed. It therefore follows that when any individual is governed by a government without his or her consent, that government is exercising unjust powers and is a usurpation. And yet in the government subsequently instituted under the Constitution, one half of the people, the women, were denied representation at the onset, while under the ban of slavery and other constitutional bars, the number permitted to express consent or dissent was in the aggregate cut down to less than one-tenth of the inhabitants of the geographic area known as America at the time. He then goes on to say, to what a ridiculous farce do Jefferson's glittering generalities reduce themselves at the first touch of common sense? So less than 10% of the people that actually inhabited America at the time even had a say in the Constitution. So not only was it implemented unconstitutionally, but it was also implemented without the consent of 90% of the people. It doesn't sound like freedom to me. So again, how can we expect this institution to secure our individual liberty when in reality what this institution was to me was simply the privileged elite at the time, whom many refer to as the Founding Fathers, were simply securing their position of power and giving themselves more protection from what the status was before. That protection did not extend to the masses in the least bit. And to illustrate that, how the Constitution actually brought about less freedom, let's just take a quick look at Article 1, Section 8. I'm sure most in this room, if not all, have read the Constitution rather thoroughly. But if you look at it from a critical eye, from a different viewpoint, it's actually rather profound how little liberty the Constitution actually gives. Clause 1 of Article 1, Section 8, the Congress shall have the power to lay and collect taxes. I don't see why a generation that just fought a revolution against a central government would give a small central government the authority to collect taxes on the entire massive geographic area, which has since grown to 50 states. Before it was only 13. Additionally, Clause 2 of Article 1, Section 8, the Congress has the power to borrow money on the credit of the United States, which again gives a tiny elite the power and authority to take out credit on the backs of the rest of us. How can one expect that not to be abused? And again, this is before the Federal Reserve System. They already had the power to take out credit. Before the income tax, they already had the power to tax all of us. Additionally, Clause 3, Michael Bolden's going to be speaking tomorrow. Clause 3, the Commerce Clause, I don't know how anybody didn't expect that to be abused. After 1933, they said that interstate commerce applies to just about everything that you can do. They said if you're selling vegetables in your own backyard, it could potentially affect the vegetable sales of other farms in other states, even though nothing ever crosses state lines. So I would have nixed that one. I think perhaps they weren't creative enough to think of, you know, maybe trade associations could handle these differences in different state currencies and whatnot. Take it on to Clause 15. And this is essentially why I believe that the Constitution was nothing more than securing their position of power and privilege. Clause 15 gives the Congress the power to provide for calling forth the militia to execute the laws of the Union, suppress insurrections, and repel invasions. And if you take a look at Black's Law Dictionary, you'll find the definition of insurrection is nothing more than a rebellion. Much of the rhetoric that will be spoken today and many of the activities that many individuals in the Free State Project engage in could be considered rebellion. The Occupy movement could be considered rebellion. Wouldn't you know it, George Washington, at the direction of Alexander Hamilton, actually used this constitutional clause to put down the Whiskey Rebellion, which was nothing more than some Appalachian Mountain men who were brewing their own whiskey, using it as a currency. He called up the militia. They put that down. There were deaths. Thankfully, it didn't turn into a bloody revolution. But that was a constitutional act, to use the militia to put down peaceful citizens who were engaging in commerce. That was entirely constitutional. And as if that wasn't enough, did you know that NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act, people are up in arms. It's very repulsive that they would include an indefinite detention clause that allows the president to indefinitely detain U.S. citizens. Well, what if I told you that that basic concept was already written into the Constitution? And entirely constitutional. The only difference is now that the president has the power. You check out Article 1, Section 9, limits on Congress, which don't really seem like limits to me. The privilege of the writ of habeas corpus shall not be suspended. It should stop there, but it goes on to say, unless when in cases of rebellion or invasion, should the public safety require it. So we see, of course, the respect that politicians have for liberty and security. You know, liberty's way down here. It gets a back door. So there they have the power in cases of rebellion. And it's the Congress and their courts that can determine what exactly rebellion is. They have the power to suspend habeas corpus. So when NDAA rolled around, I wasn't very surprised at that act. It's actually written into the Constitution. And Abraham Lincoln utilized that during the Civil War. He constitutionally suspended habeas corpus, locked up some of his opponents, and threw away the key without any representation. This, of course, flies in the face of the revolutionary document, the Declaration of Independence, which says we have the right to alter or abolish our government. Well, the Constitution would say otherwise, and it gives those governments the power to suppress insurrections and to put down rebels, like I see in this room. And then couple all that with the Department of Homeland Security nowadays. They say it's a suspicious activity. You might be a domestic terrorist if you use security passwords on your computer at an internet cafe, if you use cash at an internet cafe, if you trade in silver. You freaking terrorists out there. I'm just looking at all y'all. I feel really insecure right now. So while I agree that the Constitution does represent the furthest that mankind has come to an institution that actually limits government, I think we can do better. I think we can do much better. It was Lysander Spooner, of course, that said, whether the Constitution be one thing or another, this much is clear. Either it has caused the problems we have today or prevented them. Either way, it is unfit to exist. Many people in the liberty movement call for the restoration of the Republic or a return to the Constitution. I don't want to go back to that. I don't want to return to that. I want to move forward. I'm not a constitutional conservative. I'm a radical liberal. I'm an agorist. I want to move forward. I think we can do better as mankind. And we all know how hard it is to manipulate and to change this federal government and how much it interferes with local and state activities. Another thing, I'm not for revolution. I'm for peaceful evolution. I ripped that term off as I rip off many ideas from the Free State Project. I don't know if the Free State Project came up with that, but I'm not about revolution, because if you take a look at the word revolution, all it is a series of cycles revolving over and over and over again. It was Thomas Jefferson that said we need a revolution every generation. I don't want that. I don't want to fight a violent revolution. I'm not a violent person. I'm a peaceful person. I certainly don't want that for my daughter. I don't want her to grow up to have to fight a revolution, for her children to have to fight a revolution. And the reason why they have to fight a revolution, or they believe they have to fight revolutions, is because they believe they need to take control of the institution of monopoly power. I believe we need to abandon that institution, and then we can end this cycle of blood, despair, violence, and revolution. The next point I want to bring up about a difference between Agenda 21 and Agora 21 is Agenda 21 would see the ultimate centralization of power and authority in the hands of a very small, tiny elite at the international level, the highest level. Agora 21 would bring that authority and power all the way to the individual and the community. And as we shall see, it's my opinion, but I think it's backed up by some pretty good solid research and empirical facts that we can't have individual liberty with the presence of a government or with a state. So what is a state? Murray Rothbard defined the state as an institution which possesses one or both, almost always both, of the following properties. One, it acquires its income by the physical coercion known as taxation. And two, it asserts and usually obtains a coerced monopoly on the provision of defense services over a given geographic area. And it's the legitimacy, I believe, that is most dangerous to our individual liberty. The idea that individuals believe the state is legitimate, that if you walk around with a blue uniform and a badge, you are a legitimate authority. Just think about it. If I were to walk up to somebody out on the street, clock them in the head with a baton, tase them, take their money, take their wallet, I would be locked up. I would be held accountable. But just because someone has a gold shiny badge, as many in the Free State have learned, they can get away with that. And in fact, they can get away with murder. And they are murdering young African-American youth in the city of Austin. There's an epidemic in the city. And nobody's held accountable. The district attorney isn't holding anybody accountable. And it's because they have that badge and that supposed legitimate authority that they're able to abuse us so much. Quick little story. I was driving to Nullify Now, Missouri, Kansas City, Nullify Now, Kansas City, from Texas. And I was driving in what me and Catherine call the sovereign citizen mobile, because it's her car with expired tags and no registration. And the reason is because the state of Missouri has a property tax on vehicles. And while Kat worked her behind off and paid off her car when she was young, fresh out of college, they still insist on taking $500, $600 every year. Well, Catherine and I, being the free individuals that we are, of course, we never paid after she left Missouri. So I'm driving through Oklahoma with a car full of goods and from Brave New Books, the store that I work at down in Austin. And we get pulled over by Muskogee County Sheriff's Department. I don't know if you heard this. I'm an Okie from Muskogee. Well, these guys were some slack-jawed yokels if I'd ever seen any. And, you know, they call the police dog, they call the drug-sniffing dog out on us. And I said, well, do you need a warrant or probable cause to call the dog out? He says, nope, here in Oklahoma, we can do that. And you had to look. And my friend, of course, had a camera in his face, and he looked into the camera like he was proud. In Oklahoma, we could do that here. So they brought the drug dog out. Thankfully, the drug dog failed. I don't know if he needs to go back to drug dog school or not. But, yeah. Long story short, I haven't gone to court for that, by the way. I don't have an Oklahoma driver's license, and I'm going to refuse to deal with that matter. Now they've turned it over to a collections agency, like I've already been found guilty. Thank goodness my credit's already shot to hell. It doesn't really matter. We're establishing free banks. Doesn't matter the existing credit system, right? That's what I keep telling myself. So I don't want to take out that debt-based money anyway, you know, with the interest on it. It's all usury. So long story short, because the tags were expired and because I didn't have insurance on the car, I didn't have my insurance card. Kat did have an insurance. No, actually, no, she didn't have it insured either. Whoop. They ended up impounding the car. They stole our vehicle. They left me and Steven, my roommate, on the side of the road with all of our goods. We had to stash them in a ditch. We walked up the road to the local casino. We had to call our friends from Missouri to come grab us. Thankfully, we made it in time to participate in the Nullify Now Missouri event. But I told one of the officers there, there's about four or five of them, of course, the whole time I'm berating him and cop blocking him the entire time. And I said, hey, can I tell you a joke? And he said, well, sure, you can tell me a joke. And I said, what's the difference between a highway robber and a police officer? And I said, when the highway robber takes your stuff, he doesn't tell you he's doing it for your own good. And the police officer just looked at me with a blank stare. He didn't get it, so I proceeded to explain that concept for another 5 minutes. But it reminded me of it's a Lysander Spooner joke. Of course, Lysander Spooner, the individualist anarchist I referred to earlier. And Lysander Spooner goes on to say, furthermore, having taken your money, he leaves you as you wish him to. He leaves you as you wish him to do. He does not persist in following you on the road against your will, assuming to be your rightful sovereign on account of the protection he affords you. He does not keep protecting you by commanding you to bow down and serve him, by requiring you to do this and forbidding you to do that, by robbing you of more money as often, he finds it fit for his interest or pleasure to do so, and by branding you as a rebel, a traitor, and an enemy to your country, and shooting you down without mercy if you dispute his authority or resist his demands. He is too much of a gentleman to be guilty of such impostures and insults and villainies as these. In short, he does not, in addition to robbing you, attempt to make you either his dupe or his slave, as of course government does. Government's also an awful lot like the mafia, I forget her name, a Free Stater, maybe she's in the room. Yeah, there you go. She gave the great 10 reasons why the mafia is better than the state, which was great. But yeah, it's exactly like the mafia. And for anybody that owns a small business, they would exactly understand that. They come around their state bureaucracy, and it's just like the mafia. They come up to your door, and they say, hey, we're running a protection agency here in the city of Keene. We need to protect you. It's a scary place out there. And the business owner, well, you know, actually, I feel like Keene's a pretty safe place. You know, I don't think I need your protection. I open carry a firearm. My employees are armed. We can defend ourselves, thank you. Okay, well, you better, you know, you do your business at your own risk. And then a week later, you find a brick through your window, and, you know, one of your employees gets roughed up. It's exactly the same thing as the government does. They'll come around, and unfortunately, government is force. And if you try to operate a business publicly now without a license, you will feel the force of government fall down upon you. They are no different from the mafia. The only difference is they have the supposed legitimacy of authority, which I believe to be absolutely dangerous. Now, some libertarians, most libertarians, are against socialism. There's some left libertarians that are for some sort of anarcho-syndicalism, anarcho-socialism. I think we ought to reject the state entirely. Some people think we ought to use the state to socialize the provision of defense and justice. I think that that's a fallacy. I think that markets or communities can provide defense and justice in a manner that is more effective, efficient, and equitable, for the lefties out there, and just as well. I include all sorts of left rhetoric in my discussions. I believe myself to be a radical leftist, not a right conservative, because I want to abandon the old institutions, but also there's so many liberals and lefties in Austin, it helps to influence them. Minarchists claim that the only rule of government is to protect life, liberty, and property of the individual. But in order to do that, they necessarily have to violate the property of the individual through taxation. Some may argue that taxation is voluntary and some individuals subscribe to it, but to counter that, they wouldn't need to make it forceful if it was voluntary. I believe everybody would opt out of it. Many people argue we need a government to protect us because there's evil people in the world, and these evil people and evil corporations will harm us. Well, first off, there wouldn't exist corporations with their privileged power of protecting them from liability if it wasn't for state government. And second of all, if you're going to create an institution of monopoly violence to protect you from evil people, who's to say those evil people aren't simply going to inhabit that institution and now perform their evil acts, but again, with the veil of legitimacy, which is so dangerous. And yeah, government is precisely the type of institution that these evil individuals who are willing to exploit others for their own ends will flock to. And the problem with government is it's necessarily parasitic. So everyone is damaged whenever individuals take control of government to further their own ends. And then another thing, governments claim, and the U.S. Constitution claims to have a separation of powers. But, you know, it's the criminals watching the criminals, the fox watching the hen house. We've all seen the state governments look out for each other. City council protects the police, the Supreme Court protects the Congress, so on and so forth, all the way down the line. It's just a system of smoke and mirrors, pulleys and levers, and it's a big fraud, if you ask me. So what does the alternative look like? What is the alternative to the state? Well, first of all, there would be far less war, genocide, empire. There wouldn't be any democide, which is murder by government, which, if you check, is actually the number one cause of unnatural death in the 20th century. Governments murdering their citizens, and our government isn't exempt from that. So a society would essentially be organized through a series of mutually beneficial voluntary associations, contracts, and relationships. That's exactly what agorism is. That's exactly what agorism calls for. It's ruled not through coercion, but through consent, through contracts. And this isn't a new idea. This has been enumerated for 500 years now, the idea that we can build a voluntary society without the need of a monopoly institution of force. Now, the final comparison I'd like to make between Agenda 21 and Agora 21 is the difference between the main principles of Agenda 21 and Agora 21, and I'd like to further demonstrate what a free society would look like and how we would get to a free society, and also juxtapose political means with agorist means in a few different instances. So to do that, let me compare the three E's of Agenda 21, which are found in Agenda 21. They're also found in the comprehensive plans, which is a means of implementing Agenda 21 that's taking place all across the country. Your local comprehensive plan is Agenda 21. I'm going to contrast the three E's with something I came up with, the three C's of agorism. The three E's of Agenda 21 are environment, economy, and equity. And again, you'll find this in the mission and vision statement of every single comprehensive plan throughout the country. I've looked, believe me. And if it's an Agenda 21 comprehensive plan, it's there. The first E, environment, they essentially would put environment as a higher value than any other thing, whether it's personal freedom or property, which some people may agree with that. I'm sure people in this room don't agree with using government to back it up. With the economy, they would do away with free market principles, not that we have them. They would do away with the cost principle, with market and with supply and demand, and they would place values on things based on how those things affect the environment. So, for example, that, you know, they do plastic bag bans. In Austin, the energy is skyrocketing through the roof, and it's not a result of a higher demand. It's a result of them trying to deter you from using energy, and it's a terrible thing. Finally, the 30 is equity, social equity, which is essentially a devolution from the concept of equality under the law. It went from equality under the law to equal justice, to civil justice, social justice, now social equity, which is essentially egalitarianism. They're hoping to level the playing field through a massive redistribution of wealth. Additionally, they're hoping to destroy the family unit and replace it with government. And Agenda 21 has infected the public schooling process all the way from the Department of Education down to many local school boards, and they're inculcating in the minds of America's youth the philosophy of collectivism as opposed to the philosophy of individualism. So those are the three E's of Agenda 21. They use those three E's to implement Agenda 21. Now I'd like to call out the three C's of Agora 21, which are consistency, competition, and courage. And in order to further hash out what agorism is and why I believe it is the only strategy that will bring us a wholly free society, none of these half measures like the Constitution, but a wholly free society, I'll hash out these three C's, the first of which, consistency. And this is from Samuel Edward Conkin III's New Libertarian Manifesto, and I think this is basically the whole thesis of the entire project, and it's something that I hold dear to my heart. The basic principle which leads a libertarian from statism to his free society is the same which the founders of libertarianism used to discover the theory itself. The principle is consistency. Thus, the consistent application of the theory of libertarianism to every action the individual libertarian takes creates the libertarian society. And this can take place from the ground up. We need not influence Congress or elect Ron Paul in order to create a free society. If we genuinely want a free society, it's up to each and every one of us to live as free individuals, whether that means ceasing the use of the Federal Reserve Note, which I'll speak about in a little while, whether it means no longer asking permission to travel freely in the form of a driver's license, whether it means reducing your income or not filing your income tax altogether. We need to live consistently, and I know it's scary and dangerous, and I'll get into some ways that we can overcome the fear by building community, but it's the consistency which is key if we are to create a free society. The second C is competition. Now, the New Libertarian Manifesto defines the counter-economy as the actual practice of human actions that evade, avoid, and defy the state. That's what they define as counter-economic activity. So I'd like to go over a few institutions that we can engage in competition with these institutions in order to create a more free society. The first of which is the institution of food. There's many hierarchical food production systems that are very vulnerable. The supply chain could collapse. Gas goes up to $5 or $6, and you may not see groceries at the local grocery store. That's why it's absolutely important that we all begin to grow our own vegetables in our own backyards, that we engage in community gardens, get into all sorts of great technology like aquaponics, set up Liberty Gardens like they were doing during the Great Depression. They had the Victory Gardens. And what I'm going to do with these different instances is demonstrate the difference between the political means and the agorist means. So one of the problems that we all face is the problem of genetically modified organisms. This is another place for consistency. In the past 2 years, I've really got my health in line. I've cut out inorganic food. I've cut out GMOs. But I see a lot of people in the Liberty Movement, a lot of people in the Truth Movement, who are saying how bad GMOs are, and the next day they're eating a McDonald's and drinking a soda. So one thing we can do to better our lives, but also better our ability to create a free society, is to begin to live more consistent with our health and to get in better shape. And I think we'll all be more productive members of the Liberty Movement if we do that. But one of the problems people point to is the GMOs, and they say we need to call on the government to label GMOs. We need to use government force to label GMOs. It's not necessary. If you want to get GMOs out of your life, stop eating GMOs. We don't need the FDA to tell us what has GMOs. There's already competing institutions like the Non-GMO Project. So I don't think government is the solution in that particular instance. I don't think government is ever the solution. But here's an example of an agorist means of doing that, just simply educating the public about GMOs and engaging and giving your business to companies and food manufacturers who label their stuff as non-GMO without the FDA. That's the institution of food that we ought to begin creating competition with the hierarchical food production systems. The second area is health. I've been visiting a naturopath. In fact, I've just now gotten over a toothache. I was going to go to the dentist, even though I have no money and no insurance. But rather than do that and have the interventionist drilling, which everybody hates, I went ahead and created a little mixture, a paste of charcoal, clay, sugar substitute called xylitol and colloidal silver, and I've been packing it on my tooth, and wouldn't you know it, the toothache is gone. I plan to do that to my whole mouth. So I think one thing we could do to take our health into our own hands is to begin to empower ourselves to take care of ourselves through natural and homeopathic remedies. Insurance premiums are high. Some people say, well, we need the state to regulate insurance to bring it down. We need to pass this Obamacare. No, you don't need to do that. All you need to do is stop putting toxins in your body and start taking care of yourselves. The second institution is education, and the Free State is leading the way on this with unschooling, homeschooling cooperatives. It's absolutely wonderful. There's so many people that are ticked off with what their children are learning in school. They want to go run for school board. They want to go to the school board meetings and influence the government. Why not just pull your kids out of the institution? I know it's difficult, and a lot of people don't have the time for that, but there are homeschooling cooperatives. So rather than bang your head up against a wall trying to influence these a-holes who may have nothing in common with your belief system, yet they inculcate your children with their philosophy, why not go ahead and pull them out and teach them on your own, or put them in the hands of your fellow libertarians whom you trust and who share the same philosophy. So again, the agorist solution compared to the political solution of influencing school boards would be to start your own competing institution. Another thing we could set up as well, New Hampshire would be a great place, our own Liberty University. There's PhDs in the room that I believe would make great professors. We don't need the existing institutions, which are all governed by Agenda 21. You find the exact same internationalists that are the deans of so many graduate programs that are right there in the belly of the beast of the United Nations. Another area where we can compete with the existing institutions is the area of communication. And boy, have I been influenced quite a great deal by the Free State Project with the Porcupine 411 system you guys got going. Just launched Shire 911 as well. I think that's a very powerful tool that can bring individuals together and make people feel more confident when they do step out in civil disobedience or whenever they're pulled over, that you'll have a whole flock of Free Staters there with cameras on these guys to turn them from engaging in criminal activity. We launched the Lone Star Liberty Bell in Central Texas. It's similar to Pork 411, although it's not as efficient and there's a lot of bugs in it. But we've launched that, and again, inspired by the Free State Project as a means of allowing people to have a phone they can call so they can get their community there to back them up. And another juxtaposition between political solutions and alternative institutions and agorism, they got the SOPA coming up, which is going to regulate the internet. Alex Jones has been talking about the internet kill switch for years now. People call their congressmen to defeat SOPA, and while SOPA was knocked down this time around, You know it's just going to manifest itself in another way. How about we take the energy that we use to call the congressman and we go ahead and begin building our own parallel internet, which is already taking place, whether it's Darknet or whether it's the Alt Expo that I believe yesterday or today they're having a whole seminar on the ideas of banding together local internets. People can tether their wireless modems together, stuff like that. They have control. They have the ability to potentially shut down parts of the internet. Why not just take their ability to do that away altogether and set up our own internet? Another institution which I believe to be absolutely important is the counter economy and competing economies. And one thing that people are doing is setting up alternative currencies and competing currencies, local currencies. Of course, here in New Hampshire, you guys have the Shire Silver, which is absolutely groundbreaking, and really appreciate what you guys are doing with this. Shire Silver! The guys out of Phoenix, Arizona have the dime cards, which is a pre-1964 dime. They also pop quarters in there. This one happens to say, every Federal Reserve note you hold, central banks can leverage 10 times. Boycott empire. Use silver. On the back, it's got a little chart here that shows the value of these dimes when silver's 35, 40, 45, and 50. They used to just have one number, but they'd always had to change the value on there. And the guys out at Freedom's Phoenix, Drew Phillips, they're selling these today. And of course, Ron Helwig's there with the Shire Silver outside, if you guys are not familiar with those institutions. Additionally, in Austin, we set up what's called the Black and Yellow Pages, blackandyellowpages.biz. I think there's one operated out of New Hampshire, too. They got the URL, blackandyellowpages.com. Finally, New Hampshire ripped off an idea from us. But essentially, we found over 26 local businesses, many of them aren't actually participating in the libertarian movement, that are willing to accept silver and or barter. We put it into a little pamphlet. I have them here. There's also Shire Silver's in there. There's also some other institutions here from New Hampshire, a lot of local Austin institutions. It's a nationwide thing, and it's essentially a directory that we encourage people to go to. Say they have a plumbing problem, before you open the yellow pages, flip to the black and yellow pages and keep it within the community. Use silver, use barter, avoid the use of the Federal Reserve note. You know, my flight actually up here was paid for with silver. Somebody gave me frequent flyer miles and I traded silver for it. This haircut, people like it, looking kind of slick. Got this haircut with silver from a barber we have in the black and yellow pages. So obviously you can trade amongst yourselves in silver, but what I find to be really empowering is to get out into the existing community and to brush shoulders with the locals. And all of them are aware that the Federal Reserve note is going down the poop chute. And if you offer them an alternative, a viable alternative, you'll find that many of them will be interested after just a little bit of education. And then if you hold them the black and yellow pages, because most of them say, well, what do I do with this silver? We say, here's black and yellow pages. If you need a haircut, if you need a veterinarian, if you need a food from the local farmers market, black and yellow pages will show you how to do that. And then again, to juxtapose the political means with the agorist means, end the Fed is a wonderful case study. Many people think we can end the Fed by passing a piece of legislation to audit the Fed. This flies in the face of the fact that the Congress is empowered by the Fed in that they can fund their pet projects without having to increase taxes, even though they increase taxes all the time. I don't think the Congress is going to disempower themselves and never voluntarily give up their own power. If you want to end the Fed, stop using the Federal Reserve note and the Fed will end itself. And that's exactly what we're trying to do, at least reduce. If you can't stop it altogether, which is extremely difficult, especially how you're going to get petrol, that's why we go to biodiesel, another alternative institution. At least reduce your use of the Federal Reserve notes. Every time you hand that Federal Reserve note, many people say, oh, it's a Federal Reserve note. It has no value. The people that say that, I'll take your Federal Reserve notes if you think they're worth nothing. In reality, they do have value. They have the value that we attribute to them as a medium of exchange. And every time you hand over that Federal Reserve note, as this dime card said, you're actually empowering the Federal Reserve. And each one of us, in our own individual way, is responsible for the actions of the Federal Reserve because we're building value in the currency and we're giving it the ability to fund foreign wars of aggression and build a police state at home. So it needs to stop. We need to be more consistent. Every time you hand that Federal Reserve note, think about that. Think about the value you're building in the Federal Reserve note and think if there's an alternative way for you to get that good or service without using the Federal Reserve note through silver exchange or barter. Finally, the final institution I want to talk about is the Institution of Defense. And I believe this to be perhaps the most important of the institutions. Samuel Edward Konkin said we need to create agorist defense institutions in order to protect ourselves from the statist intervention. These take the forms of a local militia, a neighborhood watch group. Simply open carrying a firearm or learning how to defend yourself with a firearm in your family is a competing institution. I believe it's absolutely necessary that we begin to do these and we begin to think big and hard about this. Nobody wants to initiate violence, of course, but I believe it to be a major deterrent of police abuse for people to arm themselves and for the public to know that we know how to defend ourselves and we will defend ourselves if we are aggressed upon. In Texas, we started Lone Star Smart. It's the Sovereign Mutual Aid Response Team. It's essentially a mutual defense pact that people enter into and commit to each other to defend ourselves, not only from criminal elements in our communities, but also from criminal governmental actions. And this is all something to empower the individual to step out and to begin to engage in the counter economy, to begin breaking unjust laws, to begin to engage in civil disobedience, and to feel a little more confident in their ability to do so without being shot down by the man. Again, to juxtapose the political solution with the agri solution in this instance, there's police abuse going on in Central Texas. It's epidemic right now. Maybe some of you have heard the story of Antonio Beeler, the Army veteran, Army Ranger, Stanford graduate, West Point graduate, school teacher. He was recently cop blocking some cops that were roughhousing a young woman, taking pictures. He ended up getting arrested, charged with felony harassment. They claimed he spit in their face. Video evidence shows otherwise. So people are looking for solutions. They say, go to the police monitor's office, which is some sort of accountability office. But the police monitor's office is underneath the police union contract. It's not even codified by law. They say, go to the district attorney. The district attorney's ran by the local police department. So the way that we solve these problems is we get out there and we change public opinion of the police force. One thing we can do is go door knocking door to door in the neighborhoods of these abusive police and hand out literature and DVDs showing their abuse. Here in the Free State Project, of course, you guys have held candlelight vigils at judges' offices, which I think is pretty ballsy. But I think it really has a strong effect on further abuse and future abuse. And I think it's far more powerful than going to their own institutions in order to make change. So the competing institutions of defense, they're rather risky, but they're absolutely necessary if we are to find freedom in our lifetimes. And the third C, we had consistency, competition. The third C is courage. This is what I find to be the most important, because without courage, we're simply going to continue to wither away. Our freedoms are going to continue to deteriorate under the existing system. It does take a pair of brass balls or brass ovaries in order to engage in some of these activities. Especially the, can't leave the ladies out there, especially the competing institutions of defense. The state operates through fear and coercion. Last year, I paid $16 to the federal IRS. That was $16 too much. It pains me to think that even one bullet was paid for with that $16 that could be put in the head of somebody that's protesting the IRS or a young Iraqi child across the seas. They have the FDAs that's now raiding farms. They're locking people up in prison for simply smoking marijuana. People that engage in civil disobedience sometimes, police brutality is inflicted upon them. I have a driver's license. I don't want to renew my driver's license, but I'm considering it out of fear. I certainly don't want to be pulled over and tossed in a cage when I'm driving around with my daughter. Government operates on fear. It's where they get their power. And in order to overcome this fear, it's absolutely necessary that we band together and that we use courage, because we are all free people. They're just holding us down because we're afraid. And it's okay to be afraid. I'm afraid. I used to say that I wasn't afraid, but somebody pointed out. I was actually at a dinner with G. Edward Griffin after he spoke in Austin. I said, yeah, I'm not afraid of all this New World Order stuff. And G. Edward Griffin said, well, if you're not afraid, you're lying. And that really had a big impact on me. I was lying through my teeth trying to be a tough guy. But I am afraid. And I just want you guys to know that it's okay to be afraid. And I hope that you'll take heart in the fact that, you know, while it is a scary world out there, while they have Agenda 21, massive programs to create a totalitarian world government, while the police state is growing by leaps and bounds from a bear cat in Keene to the Department of Homeland Security labeling us all as homegrown terrorists, to the prospect of FEMA detention centers, which is no conspiracy theory, we need to take heart in the fact that there's strength in numbers, there's strength in unity, and there's strength in truth. And as a movement, we have all three of those things. So all we need to do is recognize that we are inherently free. We need to band together and defend one another. And if we do that, there'll be no putting us down, and we will be able to realize our inherent freedom. So that's a message I want to bring today. That's what Agora 21 is all about. We all have it in ourselves to create a free society. It's necessary for us to abandon the fallacy that government can protect our life, liberty, and property. Let's stand up together, and there's no holding us down. Thank you.